Abilities helped revolutionize how good or bad a Pokemon was back when they were first introduced in Ruby, Sapphire, and Emerald for Generation 3. Some were incredibly beneficial, such as Levitate or Moxie, but there were also some abilities that just cripple a Pokemon. And one of my favorites gets one of the worst. Let's find out how easily you can beat Pokemon White version with only Klutz Golett. If you're well-versed in Pokemon lingo, then you know exactly why this challenge is going to be brutal. Klutz literally negates me from using held items of any kind, so that means I won't be able to use the Evulite item, which boosts my defense and special defense by 50% as long as I'm unevolved. Now, I know that in competitive play there are some Klutz sets that people like to use, but in a challenge playthrough, there is little worse. Also, since this is Generation 5, the amount of experience that I get from grinding is significantly different also. More on that later though, but I'm thankful for the fact that Klutz doesn't prevent me from using the Lucky Egg. For the rules, obviously I can only use Golett in battle. I'm also restricting myself from using items in battle, aside from Pokeballs in order to catch Pokemon for certain HMs that I need in order to progress through the story. And of course, I can't use glitches to make this easier. So the game starts off, and I use the Universal Pokemon Randomizer to give myself a Golett instead of Tepig. This results in Charon getting Oshawott and Bianca getting Snivy. Typically in this game, Charon takes the starter that has the type advantage against you, whereas Bianca takes the one that you have the type advantage against. However, since Golett is a ghost and ground type Pokemon, both of my rivals will have the type advantage against me throughout our adventure. You can see that I'm really trying to be as masochistic as possible, especially after how easy my Sword and Shield in-game trade only run was. Check that out after this video. It was my first challenge run ever and I had so much fun with it. Link in the iCard and the description. It's not like we really need to worry about the type advantages though, because all Oshawott and Snivy have at the moment is Tackle, so they can't even touch me. We name our Golett Tiny Giant, since it's not quite the Iron Giant just yet, and we make our way to Stryaten City. However, on my way there, I completely forgot that Patrat and Lillipup get bite super early, and we go down for the first time because I was caught with my pants down. We also have our second battles against Bianca and Charon as well, but they were also just incredibly easy, thanks to our newly acquired move, Rollout, a rock move that progressively increases in power the more times it connects. I go on to take on the first gym leader, and to cut to the chase, it does not go well at all. His Lillipup just utterly destroys us with Work Up and Bite, and it doesn't help that we're fighting Cress, whose ace is a water-type starter, so Panpour hits us really hard too. I grind up for a little bit and get one of our best moves for this run, Shadow Punch. It's only 60 base power, but it's stab and it always hits. I really can't complain. We do lose a few times, but we were thankfully able to win one run because Cress thought going for Work Up was a better idea than taking me out with a water gun. Well, first badge is acquired, I guess let's move on. We have our third battle against Charon, but still it was incredibly easy because Oshawott and Purloin each fell to Rollout. This move is honestly going to be a saving grace for us this early on in the game. However, it's not going to be a big help for Nacrene City. Once we get there, we have our battle against N. Although he's incredibly easy, again, everything goes down to Rollout, so we try to take on Lenora, and I was feeling pretty cocky here, but we go down to her first trainer who has a Patrat with Crunch. We went down to her twice. The amount of Pokemon with a strong Dark-type move this early in the game is just astounding to me. So we go to pick up the TM for Rock Smash, and we make our way to Lenora with multiple close calls along the way. Our battle with Lenora begins, and we're already at a disadvantage because she starts off with a Herdier that has the Intimidate ability, which lowers our attack stat by one stage. Yeah, we're doing little to no damage, and she does a truckload of damage to us, so we need to grind more. After beating every trainer available and beginning our genocide on Audino, we go back to Lenora, and we've tried multiple times, but we were finally successful at level 24. After all the times that we went at her and she took us down with bites and crunches, she literally did nothing but leer me the entire time that we just rolled out. We literally did not take a single point of damage in that fight. Pinwheel Forest is pretty uneventful as you may expect, so once we reach Castellia City, we gotta help Bianca get her mana back from Team Plasma, and then we go to take on the Bug-type gym leader, Bird. Now, if I'm being honest with you, I really did not expect that much of a challenge here, because we have Rollout and he's a bug-type gym leader. What's the worst that could happen? What could possibly go wrong? Well, it's his Leovanni that causes me the most problems. His Whirlipede and Dwebble easily go down to Rollouts, but our first attempt against his Leovanni leads to him protecting, which brought our Rollout damage output back down to the minimum amount of damage that it can make. And then he just outspeeds us and hits us with a Razor Leaf, which takes us out in one hit. Well, you know what we gotta do now. We run through just about everyone in Castellia City, and we take him on again, but we still lose for the exact same reasons. So we do some grinding at Route 4, and finally at level 30, we're able to finish him off and get our third gym badge. I know I purposely made this challenge more difficult than my last one, but I didn't expect to have this much trouble with the first three gyms. Before we head to Nimbasa City though, we do have some more rival battles against Bianca and Sharon, but they really don't pose any kind of threat right now, so I'm not even gonna bother talking about them. Heading to Nimbasa City, I try to avoid as many trainers as I can since I know I'm not gonna have that hard of a time fighting Elisa. At level 33, we take her on and we just click Rollout, honestly. Like, what other option do I have? This takes her entire party down, but it only leaves us with 18 health to spare. We got through that one a lot more banged up than I thought we would, but okay. Immediately outside of Nimbasa City, we have another battle against Sharon, but we actually lost to him this time due to his Liper dealing a ton of damage to us, resulting in his DWAT taking us out. We throw ourselves back at him, and he decides that Focus Energy is just so much cooler than a super effective water move. So, Rollout rolls right through his team. Pun intended. Surprisingly, Clay actually went incredibly well, and I was kinda dreading this fight. But thanks to Krokorok going for Swagger on us, we decimated everything, taking out Krokorok, Palpitoad, and Excadrill in a few hits, because they each decided to go for Swagger, Aqua Ring, and Home Claws, respectively. Again, it's another gym battle where we literally got through completely unscathed. Immediately after that fight, we have our battle against Bianca, and she's relatively easy. Her Herdier does intimidate us, which lowers our attack, but we're able to take it out and Panpour before Servine comes out and Leech Seeds us, and then takes us out with a few Leaf Tornadoes. Second try, and instead of Herdier hitting us with Crunch, she goes for Workup instead, so it goes down easily. I decide to set up Rollout this time against Panpour, so that we hopefully have enough momentum to take out Servine, and thankfully we do. And then we take out Musharna with our final Rollout. I'm honestly dreading the future Bianca fights. Intimidate really cripples us, especially when she eventually gets her Stoutland, and she always leads off with that. A few things happen once we get to Chargestone Cave. Firstly, Professor Juniper gives us the Lucky Egg, which increases the amount of experience we gain from battles. Surprisingly, this isn't impacted by Klutz, but it helps make a huge impact on grinding. I also make sure to teach Golett Bulldoze over Magnitude to hold us over until we get Earthquake in a few levels. Magnitude is a bit too risky, and I'd much rather have guaranteed damage than a dice roll. We also have our next battle against N, but again, you know, he's really not that hard. Practically everyone on his team goes down easily, but his Ferroseed did about half of our health and recoil damage thanks to its Iron Barbs ability. All in all though, it's still a really easy fight. After leaving the cave, we reach Mistralton City, and we need to go to the Celestial Tower in order to get Skyla, the gym leader, to go back to the gym. I decided to do some additional grinding to get Golett up to level 45 in order to learn Earthquake, the best move that we will ever learn on this adventure. It's not going to help us at all against Skyla, but it's great to have for future fights. It's time to fight Skyla, and I am not going to sugarcoat this. We had to go at her multiple times. Each member of her team can easily go down when we set up Rollout, but if her Swoobat does too much damage to us, Swanna outspeeds and takes us out with a Bubble Beam. And if we ever get past Swanna, Unpheasant outspeeds and almost always takes us out with Air Slashes, flinching us a majority of the time. Rollout also has a chance to miss as well, so there's a lot of factors that are working against us in this battle. We can win this fight easily. We just need everything to work out in our favor. It took us 7 attempts, but we finally got the Jet Badge. Heading over to Twist Mountain, we have another fight against Sharon, and we lose thanks to his D-Watt's Water Pulse. I go back at about level 48, and everything goes down to consecutive rollouts. After that battle, Alder gives us the HM for Surf, so I take the time to go to Wellspring Cave and Mistralton Cave to finalize our moveset and get the TMs for Low Sweep, a fighting-type move that lowers speed, and Rock Slide, a 75 base power rock-type move And it's not as powerful as a maxed out rollout, but I'm gladly going to take that power over waiting for rollout to progressively power up any day of the week. Once we get to Icera City, we go and challenge Bryson, the Ice-type gym leader. He starts off with Vanillish, who easily goes down to a low sweep, and then he sends out his ace, Bear Tick. We hit him really hard with a Rock Slide as he swaggers us, but thankfully we are able to take him out with a low sweep. Last out is Cryogonal, but with the combination of hitting ourselves with Confusion and then getting hit by Aurora Beam, we lose very easily. This actually happens quite a few times. Swagger really is a double-edged sword in runs like these, especially when it's the first thing that his Bear Tick always goes for. Thankfully, on our fourth attempt, we were able to break through Confusion enough times to take out Bear Tick and Cryogonal. After we fight Team Plasma in Dragon Spiral Tower and encounter and befriending Reshiram, we need to go find the Darkstone in order to stand up to him at the Pokemon League. But, you know, there's nothing really interesting that happens here aside from what I just said, so let's fast forward a little bit. Trying to move past Route 9 is our last main battle with Bianca in the main campaign, and oh my god, was this fight obnoxious. Remember how I mentioned how Intimidate really cripples us? Yeah, this fight is exactly why. Stoutland just does way too much damage to us, and if we ever take it out, we just go down to Superior. We started fighting Bianca at level 54, and we did not emerge victorious until we were level 67. With this run, where Stoutland went for Work Up instead of Crunch, Superior went for Coil as we thankfully crit with a Shadow Punch, and then Musharna and Simipour go down easily. That was brutal, to say the least. Definitely our most difficult battle this entire playthrough so far. We arrive in Opelucid City, and honestly, Iris was incredibly easy since we're practically level 70 by this point. Fracture, Drudigan, and Haxorus all go down to Earthquakes and Low Sweeps. Nothing exciting here. We have our final battle against Charon, and honestly, this was a little bit of a tough fight, but not as tough as Bianca's. Unfezant goes down to a Rock Slide, but Samurott comes right out and takes us out with an Aqua Tail. We outspeed, thankfully, but we just barely miss the KO with Earthquake. This happened twice to us. There's a possibility that this could have just been a damage range, but I go and level up to level 70 just to be safe. Unfezant still goes down to a Rock Slide, Samurott and Simisear go down to an Earthquake, and Lightbird goes down to a Low Sweep. Like I said, you know, it was tough, but a lot more manageable than Bianca. Let's hope that the Elite Four is not that bad. Grimsley, as you can imagine, is the biggest brick wall for me in my Elite Four challenge. Each of his team members hit incredibly hard with really powerful Dark-type moves, and without the Ebulite, we do not take them very well at all. At level 72, his Scrafty takes us to below half with a Crunch, just for Crocodile to come out and finish us off because he outspeeds and hits us with a Foul Play. With that defeat, I decide to take on the other members just to see how I fare against them. Chantal was pretty easy, but something happened during this fight that got me thinking about our final battle in this game. I'll get to that later, though. Like I said, she was pretty easy, though, with everyone going down to a Shadow Punch. Cofagrigus could have gone down in one hit, but we got a low damage roll our first turn. Thankfully, we did avoid Will-O-Wisp. If we did get burned, we probably would have had to start that one over. Caitlyn's pretty easy, too, since she has Psychic-type Pokemon. And like Chantal, though, you know, Reuniclus, Sigilyph, Musharna, and Gothitelle all went down to Shadow Punch. Sigilyph did a lot of damage to us from an Ice Beam, and Gothitelle surprisingly outsped us and almost took us out with a Shadow Ball, and we could have had to redo that one too. Marshall isn't too hard either, but he takes a lot longer this time since we have nothing super effective against him. His throw hits us really hard with a Payback, so I'm a bit on edge from that, but he goes down to a few Earthquakes and Low Sweeps. Sock is out next, and he outspeeds us, but his Stone Edge does not hit us that hard. Thankfully, he didn't have Sturdy, or I might have gotten really concerned. Like right now, how Conkeldurr survived an Earthquake and hit us with the Stone Edge too. We are literally at 32 health, and his Mien Shao is coming out next, which can definitely outspeed us. Rock Slide leaves us with 6 HP as he goes down to an Earthquake. Christ, we came out of that one much more banged up than I thought. Alright, it's time to go refight Grimsley, and as you can imagine, he's still an incredibly difficult fight. Even with a few extra levels, we still cannot take out his Scrafty in one hit. So we're incredibly banged up when Crocodile comes out. We go down to crunches, sadly. It's just inevitable. I try it one more time, and thankfully we're able to actually crit the Scrafty with a Low Sweep, which leaves us really healthy for Crocodile. We might actually be able to do this. Unfortunately, he goes for foul play, and that takes us down to a quarter of our health. So when we take Crocodile down, Liepard just comes out and takes us out with a Night Slash. I decide to grind for a while, and we're finally able to beat Grimsley at level 82 in this one run where Crunch from Scrafty does a little above half our health, but a few low sweeps take it out. Crocodile goes for a foul play, and we hang on with 2 HP as we take it down with 2 low sweeps. We're able to take out Bisharp and Liepard as well, since we thankfully outspeed. I don't know how we outsped that Liepard, but thank God. With that out of the way, it's time to battle N for the final time. We catch Zekrom and we put him in the PC, but we cannot win this fight where we're at. Reshiram hits us way too hard with a Fusion Flare, and we can take out Vanillix easily, but immediately after Vanillix comes Karakasta, who has Sturdy, meaning that he will live any fatal hit on 1 HP. So whenever we hit him, he retaliates with a Waterfall and then finishes us off with a Priority Aqua Jet. Even at level 85, we still can't beat him. We go down to the exact same scenario. So I decide to bite the bullet and just level up to level 100. I was on the verge of grinding up there just for Grimsley alone, but I did not expect Karakasta to be that much of an issue for me. At level 100, our stats are 272 HP, 226 attack, 119 defense, 80 special attack, 130 special defense, and 146 speed. So our HP and attack are stellar, but for being at the max level, our stats otherwise are pretty lackluster. Anyway, we take on N, and we're able to outspeed and one-shot everything but Karakasta due to Sturdy. Even at level 100, his Waterfall still does practically half my health. Kinda curious to see how much Aqua Jet would have done if he'd gone for it afterward, but thankfully he didn't. Finally, we have our last battle in the entire game against Getsis, and I can finally talk about that plan that I mentioned back when I fought Chantal. So like I said, Klutz negates our ability to use any kind of hold item aside from something such as the Lucky Egg. And Getsis has a really scary team with a lot of Pokemon that hit like a truck, such as Hydreigon, Seismitoad, and Bisharp. With our stats, I genuinely don't think that we stand a chance, so what we're gonna do is we're gonna take advantage of his first Pokemon, Kofagrigus' ability in Mummy. Mummy is a really weird ability that transfers onto whoever touches that Pokemon. The ability literally has no other effect. It just spreads like wildfire. It's kind of like a certain event going on in the world right now, am I right? Since Kofagrigus is a ghost-type Pokemon and is weak to Shadow Punch, I go for it in order to get Mummy instead of Klutz, which allows me to use our Eviolite this battle in order to survive more hits. With this strategy, Kofagrigus goes down to Shadow Punch, Seismitoad goes down to an Earthquake, and Hydreigon, the one that I actually anticipated to go down in one hit because it's pretty frail, survives a low sweep on a minimum roll and hits us really hard with Surf. Now, chances are if we did not have the Eviolite, that probably would have taken us out. Electros goes down to a Shadow Punch, and his Bisharp and Bouffalant go down to a low sweep. We have successfully beaten Pokemon White with only Klutz Golett. That was a really weird run, but I had so much fun with it. I definitely expected Grimsley to be a massive brick wall in this adventure, but I did not expect to have as rough a time as I did at the beginning of the game, and especially that final Bianca battle. That was brutal. I probably grew a few gray hairs just from that fight. The fact that so many Pokemon also early game have a bunch of strong Dark-type moves was something I never really considered either. But nonetheless, I definitely recommend this run. There's definitely some segments that could have been improved here and there. I caved and leveled up to level 100, but I'd love to see if you guys can beat this at a lower level. If you enjoyed that run, be sure to like the video, comment down below some runs that you'd like to see me do. Any game is up for a challenge run, and of course, be sure to subscribe to the channel, follow my Twitch account, and be sure to like and comment on the video. Thank you all so much for watching. And I'll see you all in the next one.